The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... I'm E.G. Marshall. Let's say it's a bright summer day with the sky high and blue, and you are half dozing in the shade of a tree out in the country or on your patio. A dense, dark shadow passes over you, and for the briefest moment, you shudder to the marrow of your bones with such intense cold that, for that moment, heart, breathing, feeling, life stops dead. You open your eyes and look up, but there is nothing in the clear sky. Then you will know that over you has passed one of the ghost planes.
Does the plane always come down this fast?
It depends on the pilot. This one seems to be quite a cowboy.
Well, it's hard to hear. My ears are kind of stopped up.
You can pinch your nose like this, huh? Blow gently. Is it better?
Yes, Mr. Moore.
Now, listen to me. I don't know what you plan to do, but when we land, whatever it is, I'm getting off this plane. If you take my advice, I advise you to do the same thing.
Our mystery drama, The Ghost Plane, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Richard Crenna and Janet Waldo. It is sponsored in part by Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, Brewers of Budweiser, and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Intents and purposes, the plane in which we are traveling is not different from any normal jet, a 707 or perhaps a DC-9, with two exceptions, perhaps. There is no first class, as if it were a charter plane, and it carries only two lone passengers, both of them apparently asleep. There are many other differences in this plane, but I leave you to discover those for yourself.
Wake up, Jenny. Wake up, Jenny. Wake up, Jenny. Wake up, Jenny.
Where am I? A plane? I wasn't going on a plane, was I? Who was I? If I am, where to? What for? I can't be awake. Feel. And yet I'm not asleep, I know that. I can hear the engines, feel the vibration. Oh, there's a stewardess. Except she looks so old. I never saw an old stewardess on a plane before. But at least I can ask her. Oh, why did she have to stop by him? They don't talk too long.
Herb Moss, wake up. Herb Moss, wake up. Herb Moss, wake up.
I must have fallen asleep. It's funny, I don't feel tired. I can't remember. Chicago, St. Louis. No, I didn't have an out-of-town trip this week. Did I? It wasn't up at the lake. Well, then, how... Oh, stewardess!
Yes, sir. Can I help you?
The seatbelt light is out, so I guess it's safe to smoke.
In the rear of the plane, it is permitted to smoke.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, how about rustling me up a double martini real dry to go with that?
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Moss. There are no drinks served on this plane.
Not even a little wine with dinner?
No meals I served, either.
No. That's the way it is with charter flights, huh?
You could call this a charter flight. Yes, sir.
It's not a through flight, I guess. There'll be some set-downs.
That's correct, sir.
Well, I hope for your sake business wasn't all that bad. Just two of us. How many are you expecting at the next stop?
I don't know that yet. Excuse me. I think I'm wanted up front, Mr. Moss. May I be of assistance, Miss Wallace?
I know you're going to think this is real dumb of me, but I fell asleep. And waking up, I'm so spaced out, I can't remember. I mean, where are we going?
I'm sorry, dear. I'm not allowed to tell you that.
You mean I'm some sort of prisoner?
Oh, no. No, not at all. You can go anywhere in the plane you like, except the cockpit, of course. Now, if you'll excuse me, I think perhaps the captain wants to talk to me.
Well, no, wait. Wait, please. Oh, just a minute. There's so many things I want to ask you. I
really wouldn't do any good. I wouldn't be able to answer.
Well, just one thing. Is this some sort of a hospital plane or something?
I've told you all I can tell you.
Oh, Lord, what is it? Some awful dream. I'm scared. Oh, Mom. Pop. Someone, please. I'm so scared.
Oh, excuse me, miss.
Oh. Hi.
Hello. Well, there are only two of us in the whole plane, so... Well, to tell you the truth, I could use some company.
So could I. Oh, wait a minute. I'll slide over so you can sit down. Oh,
thank you. My name is, just a minute. I should have my, it's my business card. Herbert Moss. I'm in, I'm with Troy Train and Kenward. That's an advertising firm. Well, as long as we're talking together, I think I should ask your name.
Me? Oh, it's Ginny. Ginny, she called me. Oh, wait a minute. Let me look in my bag. There ought to be... Yeah, here. My ident card. Ginny Wallace. That's me. Lousy picture, huh?
No, not at all. Nobody your age takes a bad picture. You also didn't seem to be sure of your name, Ginny. Ginny, right? But don't look so scared, dear. You have company. Why do you think I went groping for my business card? I wasn't sure of mine either.
No kidding. You weren't honest?
Honest? I'll tell you more than that. I don't know how I got on this plane. Do you?
No.
And I can bet you something else. You probably don't know where this plane is headed for, do you?
No, I don't. And the stewardess wouldn't tell me.
Or me. Another thing. I've looked through all my pockets and I can't find any carbon copy of my ticket, luggage checks, anything like that.
I feel so scared. You don't think it's like one of those skyjack things and where the hostage is like... I mean, well, I could figure you, but why me?
Skyjack? No, I don't know. It's possible, except...
Except what?
Well, why don't we know who we are? Remember where we're going. Let's try some questions. Do you have any brothers or sisters?
Sure. Two sisters and a brother.
How old are they?
Younger than me. Mary's 14, Margaret's 11, and Tommy's only 7.
And your mother and father?
Pop died a while back. Mom's alive.
You live with the family?
No, I was going to say I didn't anymore, but... Well, it's going sort of blank again.
All right, now let's not push it. Or you. All right, let's think about me.
Well, we know you work at an advertising agency. What do you do there?
I'm an account executive, vice president in charge of Magnum Brands.
Well, I
bet you live outside the city and travel in commuter trains with bar cars and all like that. And I bet you're married, right? With kids near my age?
Yes, yes. Brian's at college already, and Adrienne is... Yes, of course I'm married, and I live in Greenridge. Wait a minute. There's a picture of the kids a couple of years ago, and it's my wife, Nina. Here's some other pictures of the kids. And that's the house. And this one, too.
Oh, beautiful. Oh, whoops, how you dropped one. Who's this?
Hmm? Oh, that's my secretary, Barbara. Oh, good Lord.
What is it, Mr. Moss?
Well, nothing. No, it's nothing. I forgot to leave her some instructions about a meeting. What day is this?
I don't know. I don't even know the day.
I have a feeling it's terribly important for us to know just what this day means. To both of us.
Oh.
Jenny, what is it?
Oh, just the way you said it. You gave me goosebumps all over.
I know the feeling. I don't like anything about this. Look, on a plane like this, there should be more than one hostess. I'm going up front to get some information about where this plane is going. Why don't you go aft and see if there isn't another hostess in the galley?
You mean like in the back?
Yes, I'm going to check the pilot.
Okay, Mr. Moore.
Pilot? Pilot or somebody? I want to talk to you. I demand that you open this door.
This is your captain. Will all passengers please notice that the no smoking lights are on and that seat belts be fastened? Please resume your seats immediately. We are preparing to land. Passengers will resume their seats immediately and buckle their seat belts. Please put out all cigarettes. We are preparing to land.
Oh, we're falling, Mr. Moss. The plane is falling.
No, it's all right, Jenny. We're just diving a bit deeply. That's all.
I feel kind of sick to my stomach.
Now, slide in and sit down. Sit down.
Oh.
That's the girl. Oh. Now, keep your mouth open and swallow. And fasten your seatbelt. Hold up tight.
Oh.
Now, listen to me. I don't know what you plan to do, but when we land, whatever it is, I'm getting off this plane. I'd advise you to do the same.
I don't know. I mean, I've only got a couple of dollars.
Don't worry about that. I've got money and credit cards. Want to get off with me?
Oh, yes.
The moment I tell you to, snap open your seatbelt and head with me for the exit.
This is your captain. We are about to land. Remain in your seats, as this will be a short stop. Do not unfasten your seatbelts on landing. We shall be taking off immediately.
Pig's eye, Skipper.
What's that?
So we're down. It's funny. I never heard him drop that landing gear.
Are we all right?
Hmm. Now, as soon as we come to a halt, snap open your seatbelt and follow me.
Yes, Mr. Moss.
Okay, now.
Oh, I can't. The buckle won't open.
As soon as I get mine. Oh, damn. Oh, I knew something was up. I sure would like to know what the devil is going on.
What is it, Mr. Moss?
These damn belts are gimmicked somehow. We're trapped in our seats. Whoever they are, they're not going to let us get off.
Who are they?
I don't know, Ginny. I'm afraid even to think.
Still, it is a good question. Who are they? Where is this strange plane headed with its cargo of only two passengers? Why is the hostess an elderly woman? And what is the rest of the crew like? And why have they stopped at wherever they have stopped? And who else or what else is coming aboard? I'll return shortly with Act Two. Strange plane rests on the ground, its engines idling easily, and nothing happens. In their seats, Ginny Wallace and Herb Ross have given up struggling with the seatbelts, which refuse to unclasp, pinning them helplessly in their seats. The cockpit door remains closed. The sense of unimaginable and pending action is so palpable that both have dropped their voices almost to a whisper.
Can you see where we are out the window?
Nothing.
Now rub the window off. I can't reach.
I did, but it's just that white mist, sort of like a cloud. I mean, outside.
No lights? No movement you can see?
No. What's going to happen to us?
I don't know.
What's that?
Shh. Bring them on board.
Who is it? I can't see over the back of the seat.
I don't know about the passengers, but it's the stewardess who was up front.
How did she get to the rear of the plane?
I don't know.
Shh. That's it. Mr. Schaefer in K1. Strap him in and...
Stewardess?
In a moment, Mr. Morse. Miss Newman in S1. And Mr. Downing in S2. Make them secure.
Stewardess, I demand to be released and let off at this stop.
Thank you, boy. As soon as you're out, we'll button up and take off.
Stewardess! Do you hear me?
Didn't you hear? Why won't you listen?
We are in the takeoff run. Please do not smoke and make sure that all safety belts are fastened. Not release until a light goes on.
Do not release. He's the last. Who has a chance?
Can't you stop it, Mr. Moss? Some way?
Yes, I can't, Jenny. I think you must be beginning to realize that as well as I do.
Are you quite comfortable, Mr. Schaefer?
Who the devil are you?
The stewardess.
You've got to be kidding. An old dame like you? Hey, what kind of an airline is this, anyhow?
At the proper time, you'll know. Excuse me, I have other passengers to attend to.
Wake up, Carol Newman. Carol Newman. Carol Newman. Carol Newman.
I don't want to wake up. I don't ever want to wake up. I took care about that. What am I doing on a plane? How's this guy next to me? I don't fly tourist. Wait a minute. Let me think.
Wake up, Bruce Downing. Wake up, Bruce Downing.
No. Oh, no, I couldn't. Not now. Not now. I made the big chance. I can't blow it. I can't. Only I have. I know it. Damn motor is still running. It's still... What? I'm not under the car. I'm on a plane. It's all right. It must be all right.
Quite all right, Mr. Downing.
Yeah?
I say for the moment, it's quite all right.
Where are we headed?
On the passage you booked. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to make quite a few preparations.
Hey, wait a minute. Damn, what's the matter with this buckle?
He's messing around with it. I tried. Some new safety gimmick, I suppose. Won't release till the seatbelt light goes off.
Oh, well. What's the difference? You mind if I smoke?
No. If you have a stick, I'll join you.
Oh, no grass, ma'am. I mean, I'm strictly keep off the grass these days. Just straight old filter tip.
Did I ask for anything more?
You didn't have to. We're two of a kind, right?
And what does that mean?
We've been down a lot of the same roads.
Yeah. I've been down the same roads, I guess. Just a few more of them than you, Sonny.
You weather pretty well. And a couple of years doesn't give you any right to that sunny. You can call me Bruce
will do. I'm Carol. I've got a case of the who the hell am I, how did I get here blues, too.
I was hoping you could clue me in.
About what, for example?
Well, this flight. Where we're going, how I got here.
You think I'd be much help? You notice what I'm wearing?
Yeah. It's nice. Sort of. Yeah, I see what you mean. No use asking you if you've got a ticket.
Scarcely.
In a negligee, you can pretty well tell everything I've got. I get a blanket from the hostess. Do you have a ticket?
Not that I can find.
And you have no idea how or why you're here?
No. Well, kind of hazy. But no. Oh, damn. If we could only get out of these seat belts.
What for?
You see that couple sitting down front? The older man and the chick in the jeans?
Yeah.
I've got a crazy notion they were already on the plane before it landed. Or anyway, before it picked us up. Maybe they have some answer.
What about the mean-looking kid with the frizzy up ahead? One with the knife he's trying to cut the belt with.
I don't think I want to tangle with that character. He's riding the edge of something.
This is your captain. We have now reached our cruising altitude. And for a brief period, till our next stop, we suggest you loosen your seatbelts if you so desire, and stretch out a little. Smoking is permitted in the rear half of the plane.
Mr. Moss?
Yes, Jenny?
What did you mean about me beginning to realize what's happening as well as you do?
Aren't you beginning to remember things?
I'm not sure. It's like a bad dream. Things that couldn't really happen have happened to me, only... And the worst of all is... I don't know how to say it. How to explain.
You don't have to, Jenny. I know. I feel the same way. But sooner or later, we're going to have to face it.
No.
Jenny, my poor, dear little girl.
Excuse me for breaking up the love scene, but I'm looking for a couple of answers, man.
There's no smoking in this section of the plane.
You gotta be putting me on, man. There's five of us here. That's all there are. Who cares? Them other two are lit up.
In the proper section. And the lady beside me doesn't smoke.
Oh, you mean love child here? Don't let her give you no runaround, Dad. She not only smokes, turns on. But she's a user, I can tell.
Put that cigarette out, punk, or I'll run you aft and stick your head down one of the bowls.
Tough guy, huh? Still feel so tough?
A knife? Oh, Mr. Moss!
Take it easy, Jenny. I don't think he wants to try to use it. It's just supposed to scare me and try to prove what a big man he is.
Hey, now, don't ever kid yourself. I got nothing to lose. Now, let's answer me a couple of questions.
Such as?
Where's this plane headed for?
I don't know.
Now, don't give me that. You were here before we got up. Before... Or however we got here, you must know something.
Don't you know why you're here?
Hey, man, would I be asking you if I did? Hold it. What do you two want?
The same thing you do, apparently. Information.
Our seat belts. Mr. Moss, we can loosen them.
Yes, Jenny. I already have.
Come on. Let's start cluing us in. What is this, a prison ship or something?
And why would you think that?
Will you lay out... Hey, what's the idea to get up you're wearing?
I don't know. It's what I had on when I woke up here on the plane.
You mean you two were shacking up and he brought you aboard in your fancy nightshirt?
No, she doesn't mean that. The first time I met this lady was on this plane. I don't even know how I got here myself. And why don't you put that knife away?
And why don't you cool it? I ain't letting this out of my hand till I get a slant on what this whole gig is, see?
My name is Herbert Moss. This is Jenny Wallace.
Who cares about names?
We should get acquainted since we're all in the same fix.
Well, all right. I'm Danny. I don't know. Somebody must have slipped me a Mickey or something before I got carted on here. I can't think.
Jenny and I had trouble remembering who we were. How about you two?
A kind of a voice whispered my name to me.
Yeah, me too.
That's how I knew my name.
Yeah, right on. Same with me. Like I was coming too. Wake up, Danny. Yeah, the old bag in the uniform. She said, Schaefer. That's it. Danny Schaefer.
Downing. Bruce Downing. That's me.
And the voice said, Carol Newman. Newman!
Oh, well, great. Now we're all buddies, okay?
But look, I'm asking you, Dad, what's going on? What do you know?
I told you nothing.
Don't give me that. I heard you say something to the love chick here when I came up. Something about face it. Face what?
Doesn't anybody know? Or guess?
It's all just bits and pieces, things that won't go together. I can't remember it straight.
Yeah, it's like that for me, too.
Mr. Downing?
That's about the size of it. One thing I do... it doesn't tie in right away.
How about you, Dad?
Well, I'm beginning to remember a lot more than I want to.
All right, now what does that mean?
Now, answer me a question first. Do you remember anything?
Yeah. I remember plenty. I've held up stores, run numbers, lifted, hoisted cars, you name it, ever since I was 14 years old. But only to put something in my stomach. The last thing I do remember is I finally went for the big one. Murder One. I was robbing a store, and a cop tried to jump me. And before I could think, I had the shiv in him, and I knew he'd bought it. So that's to clear the air. I don't really care about none of the rest of you. All I want to know is what am I doing in this bleeping plane, and where are we headed, and how do we get off of here? And this time, I expect an answer, Dad. Because I think you know.
I don't. No, exactly. I'm only guessing. For two reasons.
Spill them.
First, you all heard Danny. He's done plenty to be ashamed of, even if he wouldn't admit it. I think the first part of that statement is what all of us have in common. We're all deeply ashamed of something or things we've done. That's number one.
What would I be ashamed of? Or me? I didn't do anything wrong.
Shut up! What's the other thing we got in common?
Take a look at your windbreaker, Danny.
Yeah, what about it?
There's a hole in the front.
So what?
Unzip it. Look at your shirt underneath. Or pull up your shirt and look at your chest.
Hey, come on. What are you trying to pull?
I'm trying to answer your questions for you. And for all of us.
Okay. Hey. More blood. What happened?
I'm guessing that police officer you knifed had a partner and that he shot you. Right through the heart.
I got a hole in my chest. Big slug. At least a 38. If I hit like that, I must be... Oh, no. No, I can't be.
I'm afraid you are, Danny. I'm afraid all of us are.
You mean we're dead?
This is your captain. Will you please be sure that you are seated and have fastened your seatbelts? Please extinguish all cigarettes. We are coming in for a landing now. Thank you.
Better fasten up, everyone.
What for? Not me. I'm getting off this plane when it lands, understand?
They won't allow you to. You might as well follow orders. If he increases the pitch anymore, you'll be rolling all over the floor. You could break your neck.
What difference does it make if I'm dead?
I don't know that for sure. I'm only guessing because... Because I think I remember that... I am dead.
Has Herb guessed the truth? And if he has, what are the passengers who ride this strange plane headed for at this next landing? That is, supposing the pilot can pull the plane out of the screaming dive that has sent Dan scrambling for a seat and, for the moment, the welcome restraint of the seatbelt. I'll be back in a moment with Act 3. Again, the great plane lies earthbound, or at least not in the act of flying. Again, swirling mists mask whatever may lie outside the cabin where five people sit imprisoned now. And again, the motherly but elusive stewardess superintends the boarding of new passengers. This time, only one who was seated in the very rear. And now, with his arrival, there is a new surprise.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
Hey, look, I want to talk to you. Sure, I want to get off.
Please, help me get off.
Be quiet and listen to me, please. I have something to explain. This will be the last stop before your destination. The passenger who has just come on board is the Reverend Dr. Pell. He will join you as soon as you are airborne. I will not be with you for the rest of the flight. May I wish you all goodbye and good luck.
My beloved father, I do remember that article of the Acts of Religion which does concern the wicked, and such be void of a lively faith. Must I then be denied the partaking of the body of Christ in the use of the Lord's Supper?
What happened?
Nothing. We just stopped climbing and leveled off.
Then that means the seatbelt light should be going on any minute, and then the horn will tell us that we can get off and get out of here, right?
I suppose so. For all that means.
Hey, look, we ain't dead. I ain't buying any of that bull, understand? Now, I gotta get to a dock and fix me up.
Won't do any good. Too late.
How do you know? I mean, what makes you so sure?
Because I have a hole in my chest to match yours. Look.
Your shirt is covered with blood. Oh.
I had everything. A loving wife. Fine children. Successful career. I'm 48 years old. And my secretary was 22. I took advantage of her. Made her my mistress. Promised her a marriage I knew I had no intention of going through with. I was just leaving her apartment when the young man she should have married, emotionally insane, shot me. The last thing I remember was the bullet tearing into my chest. And then the blackness. That's why I know I am dead and why I am on this plane. Why all of us are.
Why? Why me?
He said it before. We all have something to be ashamed of.
What was your scene, man?
Mention anything an actor can do to claw his way to the top, and I've tried it. I won't embarrass little Jenny by naming him. I wouldn't want to hurt a lady's feelings.
I once thought I had talent as a designer, but I had another talent that men were more interested in. It was worth quite a lot of money, I found. It was after I'd been married and my husband walked out on me when I had a kid. I'm not excusing myself. But I did have to bring up my baby till she died. And by that time, as you can see, I wasn't all that young anymore. So much in demand. And what was there left to live for? I had uppers, downers, everything. So instead of my usual two before going to bed alone, I emptied the bottle. Excuse the hearts and flowers. But it seems to be let's take our hair down time. But I thought you'd broken out of the trap.
I had. At the expense of my best friend.
Yeah, who?
An actor friend who was playing the part in Uranus. Who got me the job as understudy. His first break, too. I slipped him a Mickey before the opening night performance. That's how I went on and got all the reviews. I thought I was a big star, already had it made. Bought myself a sports job and became a party boy. Invited now instead of hired. I turned that car upside down, trying to make a right angle curve at 90. Damn right I'm dead, and I know it. And maybe I'm glad.
I killed
my baby. I deserve to die.
Hush, Jenny. Jenny, hush. I've been that bad.
I loved him so. I wanted to be married. But Mom wouldn't give her consent. She thought he was too old for me. I thought if I was having his baby, Mom would have to agree about marriage. I waited till after 3 months. And I told her. Only he walked out on me. And it was too late. Too late for the hospitals to take care of me. So I didn't want his baby anymore. And I went to him. Not even a doctor. Oh, it was murder. I deserve to die. We all do. And Mr. Moss is right. That's why we're here. And that's where we're all going. Straight to hell.
Oh, no. No, sir, not me.
Now, what do you think you're going to do?
I've been looking. The door to the cockpit is open. The shiv's enough. I'm going in there and skyjack this plane. I'm going to make that pilot turn back.
The belts are open. Come on, Bruce. We better get him.
What, do you think there's a chance?
I don't want that crazy kid to... What is it, Danny? Danny, what's the matter?
There's no one in there. No one. There's no one flying the plane.
Good Lord.
I'm afraid not, Miss Newman. Not yours or any of ours.
What do you mean, Father?
I'm not a father.
But you're still a minister. You could help us.
I wish I could, my dear. I wish that with all my heart. But you see, I am one of you. I've been listening to all of you, and I know now that's why I'm here. I no longer have any right to the name of a minister.
What brought you here to join us, sir?
The greatest sin of all. I renounced my God. I spent the last 4 years in Vietnam. I saw such suffering and misery without reason that... But I was too busy then to think of the scars it left on the mind. I was only returning to the United States, wanting to pray for those poor people I'd known and for the agony of our country and all the world that suddenly I found there were no more words. There was no more belief. Everything had been wrung from me. And my faith was gone.
How did you die?
By God's hand. I was passing a crowd, lost in my own thoughts and the struggle in my mind. And a policeman came to me and said there was a boy on a ledge, threatening to kill himself unless they found him a minister. I went up to that high place and out on that ledge, and I asked him to come in. And he said to me, "Father, why should I come back to a world where there is no God? Tell me, convince me that there is one, and I will come in." Where were the words of comfort that can only be spoken from the soul? I, who had picked this mission to devote my life to, had none to offer. And the blackness hit me. I felt myself reeling, and like Lucifer, I fell headlong into eternal damnation.
I wonder whose is the greatest sin. And does it matter after all? I'd guess that religion has touched me less than any one of you. But I still have hope.
Hey, man, what are you talking about? You're the one put the whammy on us from the beginning. You're the one first put us all behind the eight ball.
Whatever all of us did, we were human. Human, born to make mistakes. Big or little. If we didn't, we'd be God. Or gods. Each of us carries our private hell within us. I cannot conceive of anything beyond that as punishment. The whole idea of God surely means compassion.
What's that?
We're landing.
Without any approach? In midair?
What does it mean? Hey, help me.
Hey, knock it off, Danny.
Hey, ain't you scared?
Sure. But not so much after what Mr. Moss said.
Plane's coming to a halt.
Ruth, you said we were two of a kind.
Yeah?
Then can I hang on to you? I'm terrified.
Sit down, everyone. Let's not waste time.
Who are you?
Traffic control, of course.
Are we in hell?
Not yet.
May I ask where we are?
This is sort of a halfway station. We have your dossiers. You have all made mistakes of greater or lesser value. That's neither here nor there. You have reached what is usually called the point of no return. That is the point on a journey where you are exactly halfway. And so you have a choice. Do you wish to continue, or would you like to go back to where you were before the moment of finite death?
You mean we are not condemned everlastingly?
No one has judged you as yet but yourselves. None of you returns to face an easy life, but if you want to, you may.
You mean there is a God who offers us a second chance?
Of course. Everyone deserves that, don't you think?
I wonder if the memory of this tale will haunt you. And if perhaps, as it does, that mistake, that hurtful or even vicious action you may have taken, may give you a moment's pause to reconsider and perhaps to try to repair the damage. For all of us, there is a second chance. At least once. I'll be back shortly. A girl named Ginny Wallace had a fine baby girl. Carol Newman works in a center for retarded children. Bruce Newman is a successful star. Danny is serving a sentence for robbery, but is soon to be paroled. The Reverend Morgan Pell has gone back to Vietnam. We have no record of what happened to him there. And Herb Ross broke off his relationship with Barbara, who returned to her old love, while Herb wisely never troubled his wife or children with his own indiscretion. It is enough that he suffers with it in his conscience. Our cast included Richard Crenna, Janet Waldo, Casey Kasem, Virginia Gregg, and Sam Edwards. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
No wonder the police were at Mrs. Fernglass's yesterday.
Oh, poor old thing. If she had only been taking the Pan-Pharmacon.
She took too much. Now it's witch hunt is on. I may have to get rid of all the bottles I filled.
But why, dear? We're not doing any wrong.
Yeah, we know that. But the rest of them, they outside, the unbelievers, they'll want to persecute us.
But how can they find us? Nobody in the coven will come forward.
No, but Kathy might. It's a chance we can't afford to take. She's got to disappear.
Oh, do we have to, Jason, darling? She doesn't have to see the paper.
It's on every newsstand with that big headline. How can she miss it?
Well, we'll just have to keep her home.
It's dangerous. I'd have to be sure there was some way she'd never get wind of this story.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, brewers of Budweiser. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.